Okay, assalamualaikum and also good afternoon. Okay, since tak ramai lagi ada sini, mungkin kita teruskan dulu kuliah 3 hari itu. Kita berhenti di mana? Okay, mungkin kita lihat balik example ni ya, supaya kita boleh recall balik. Kita ada welding head controls. Okay, which require an accurate control system for positioning the welding head. Dan diberikan the spec, ada 3 specification di situ. Dan kita telah plotkan the 2 spec berkaitan dengan damping ratio dengan settling time into the S plate. Kita nampak region yang mana perlu the roots berada untuk memenuhi spesifikasi, dan daripada sini kita dapat satu relationship antara K1 dan K2. Okay, daripada steady state error, and then from the block diagram, okay, kita boleh generate the equation, okay, for the transfer function of the whole system. Okay, and then daripada sini kita lihat this is the characteristic equation, okay, yang mana which is equal to S multiply by S plus 2 plus K1 multiply by K2, okay, and then the whole thing plus K1, okay. Dan daripada that characteristic equation, okay, saya tak perlu discuss lagi the spec lagi, okay, and then daripada that characteristic equation, okay, yang mana mungkin with this characteristic equation, okay, kalau kita nak untuk mudahkan kita, seloknya kita simplify yang ini K1 multiply by K2 jadi satu parameter lain yang mana dia equivalent to beta. Okay, jadi senang. Ini beta sama dengan K1 multiply by K2. Dan kemudian yang ini you boleh ganti K1, you boleh gantikan dengan alpha. Ataupun kalau you nak retain SK1 pun tak ada masalah. Okay, cuma yang ini you jadikan kepada satu variables, just a constant like that. Sebab kita tahu K1 is constant dan K2 adalah constant. Okay, kalau kita replace with that, this characteristic equation kita akan dapati, okay, kita akan dapati the characteristic equation dia akan jadi macam ini. S to the power of 2 plus 2S plus beta S plus alpha, which is equal to 0. So daripada this equation, kita akan dapati yang mana for this example kita ada 2 parameter. Satu is alpha, satu lagi beta. Okay, dan kalau kita this characteristic equation kita susunkan seperti ini, kita divide by S square plus 2S plus alpha, kita akan dapat equation seperti ini. Okay, dan kalau beta kita jadikan 0, apa akan kita akan dapati? Kita akan dapati this equation akan sama dengan 0. Okay, yang mana daripada situ kita akan dapat this equation, the characteristic equation ni kita boleh susunkan yang mana the alpha akan jadi the multiplier. Okay, ni bila kita set the beta sama dengan 0. Okay, kalau kita set beta sama dengan 0, basically you ada S square plus 2S plus alpha sama dengan 0. Okay, cuma you susunkan sekarang supaya alpha jadi multiplier, so you have this equation. Okay, dan apabila kamu ada this equation, the characteristic you dah susunkan the parameter as the multiplier, and then now you can plot the root locus for alpha bila alpha is changing. Okay, so daripada sini kita akan dapati how many pole we have. Kita ada 2 pole, satu dekat S equal to 0, satu lagi at S equal to minus 2. Okay, and then there is no 0. Okay, so bila kita other that one, yang mana kita tahu antara dua root ni, the odd root dengan even root ni, kita akan ada segment of locus dekat real axis. Okay, cuma sebab sini pole, dia akan keluar daripada pole, dan sebab sini pole, dia akan keluar dari pole, dan it should be somewhere here, the breakaway point. You boleh calculate the breakaway point, what is the value. Okay, and then you akan tahu bahawa the locus akan bertemu di sini dan kemudian dia akan berpecah. Satu naik atas, satu turun ke bawah. Okay, dan selain daripada itu, okay, kamu boleh dapatkan the center of asymptote. Okay, the center of asymptote di sini kalau you kira S sama dengan kosong, S sama dengan negatif 2, jadi kosong plus negatif 2, basically negatif 2, minus dengan 0 tak ada, jadi kosong, jadi negatif 2 divided by number of pole minus number of 0, which is 2. Jadi kita akan dapati the center of asymptote will be negatif 1. Okay, and then with that, bila kita ada 2 pole without the 0, jadi maksudnya kita akan ada 0 yang located at infinities ataupun the asymptote, kita ada 2. Okay, sama dengan number of pole. Jadi bila 2, satu adalah positive 90 degree, the other one is negative 90 degree. Okay, jadi because the center of asymptote tadi di sini, maksudnya the line of the asymptote is one is upward 90 degree this way, the other one is downward minus 90 degree. Okay, jadi after the breakaway point, the root locus akan mengikuti the asymptote. Okay, toward the infinity. Okay, and if you look at this root locus, basically the system is always stable. Okay, unless, except when the alpha is equal to 0. Okay, when the alpha is equal to 0, because it is located here, so it is become marginally stable. But when you increase the alpha, basically the system becomes stable. Okay, and with this, basically you can pick any point. Okay, of course if you want, you can look back into the specification. Okay, because the area is here. Okay, so your root locus just now is somewhere here, and then this one is minus 1.33. Okay, so it should be in this area. Okay, but if you look at your root locus, just now it come out from 0 and then come out from negative 1, and then here will go up at 1, and then here will go down. Okay, so if you choose one of the root will be here. Okay, but the other root will be somewhere here, right? Okay, so only one root will be inside this is area of the specification. Okay, so even you pick that point, you won't specify, you won't fulfill the specification. Okay, and if it is, you get a complex root also, one of them will be somewhere here, another one is somewhere here, so it is also out of the specification. Okay, but anyway, since we cannot pick any point in the area of specification, but we know that we still have another parameter to vary, so just pick any point along that root locus. Okay, for example, if you pick this point, okay, if you pick this point and if you evaluate the value of the alpha here, okay, you will find that the value of alpha will become 20 in this particular point where you have one root here, another root is here, so that means it become a complex conjugate roots. Okay, let's say we just pick that one, so we get the value of alpha 20, And then because of that, we can know that the K1 multiplied by K2 is, which is equal to beta, will become 20 multiplied by K2, which is equal to beta. Okay? And if you put that K1 in this equation, the alpha, okay? Basically, okay, if we put the alpha as K1 here, as 20, okay? And then you rearrange the equation to become the beta will become the multiplier like this, okay? And then what we can do, we can plot another root locus for beta, okay? Since before we select the K1 or alpha equal to 20, which resulting in the complex conjugate roots here, okay? So if you fix the alpha equal to 20, what happened? The poles of this equation, from this equation, if you put this as a 20, you will find that the poles will be, one of them is here, another one is here. Okay, because of your selection here just now. So you have one pole here, and then the other pole is here. Okay, because if you plug 20 here, you find the roots. Basically, the roots is complex conjugate at that point. The only thing with this one, we have two poles, which is complex conjugate, and we have another one, zero, here. So the zero is located at origin. Okay? The only thing, where if you have that two poles and one zero here, okay, on the real axis, when you sketch the root locus, basically because this is the even root, the odd root, the first root, so on the side of the this root should be a segment of root locus. The only thing, because there is no more no more root on the real axis, so it just go to infinity at 180 degree. Okay, and then basically if this is the zero, you know that the root locus will travel from somewhere from here to there. It will end up there. Okay? And here also we found that because this is the asymptote here, so it will go somewhere there. So at this somewhere, at this point, actually there will be a break-in point. Okay? Break-in point. So what actually happened is that the roots coming from here. Okay, it travel, and the other one is from here, and then they will meet up at breaking point here, and then one of them will go this side, and the other one is going to this side. Okay, so this one you can calculate the breaking point where it is. Okay, and then here you can calculate the angle of departure. Okay, and then for the asymptote, okay, because we have the number of pole is 2, the number of zero is 1. So 2 minus 1 is basically 1. So there is only one asymptote, okay, because there is only one, and it will be ended at infinity at one of the asymptote. The only thing, it will end at one of the other the zero that we have here, okay? That's why the asymptote is just here, okay? And then maybe we can calculate the angle of the asymptote, the center of the asymptote, okay? Which may be somewhere here, okay? The only thing, when it is 180, is not necessary also to calculate, okay? But once we get that, we know that once it come out from here, following the angle of departure, since the asymptote is only here, and the segment on the real axis has already followed this, so there is no more asymptote that you need to follow. So what happened? This one will go in toward the break-in point, and this one also will go in toward the break-in point. Okay? So that is how we draw the second and root locus when we vary the beta. Okay? And now, with this root locus that we have drawn, okay, and then we can compare back the specification that we have just now, okay, where the specification shows that just now that it should be somewhere greater than 45 degrees, which is somewhere this area, okay, and also this one, so it's somewhere here, okay, and we know, we can see here that there is a root locus within that area. And then also by settling time, we know that it should be greater than negative 1.33, which is that this line. Okay, so basically, this root locus is greater than that, is within that area. Okay, so what you can do now, you can select a root which is on top of this root locus, okay, and within the area of the specification. Okay, for example, you can find the root here on the edge of the specification, or you can find it here, or you can select here. Okay, basically, if you select any point here, you have the conjugate here. Okay, or you can select in the real axis here. Okay, as long as it is in the area of the specification. Okay. Okay. And although when we choosing the roots location, okay, although in the real axis, this area, okay, if we select two roots here, basically it will also fulfill the specification of the system. Okay, the only thing, normally if we choose in the real axis, normally the system will become overdamped. Okay, and the reason why we always don't select the root which produce an overdamped system is that overdamped system is always slow, okay, in the response. Okay, that's why if possible we select the roots which are complex and conjugate because it is faster. The only thing, don't select the angle of theta too high. Okay, if possible, the closer it is to the real axis, the better it is. Okay, so for this example, if we select this point also, it's okay. Okay, it's a complex conjugate. We get a root as a complex conjugate. Okay, and then the angle will be around 45 degree. And 45 degree, if we calculate the zeta, basically the zeta, we get around 0.707. Okay, I think the damping ratio of 0.7, I think that's quite good lah. Okay, so you can select that point. So if you select that point and then you calculate the value of the beta, you will find out that the beta is actually equal to 4.3. Okay, how you calculate that beta? You know how to calculate the beta? We use the equation of the magnitude. You remember that when we first talk about the root locus in the first slide? Okay, about the magnitude. Okay, so basically the beta, okay, since beta is located here, okay, so you need to measure the distance from the beta to other pole, from this root, okay, to the other poles. So this distance, in fact, you can measure if your sketch is good. Okay, I think you can just measure by ruler if you want. Okay, so easier. Okay, no need to or utilize this grid to find the triangle here, more or less. Okay, the distance from here to here. Okay, multiply the distance from here, from the roots to the other poles. Okay. And then divide the distance from the roots to the zero. Okay. So if you get this distance, okay, you multiply together and then divide with this distance. Okay, by doing that, you get the value of beta, which will be 4.3. Okay, and then since we know already that before, from alpha before, that we know that the beta is equal to 20 multiplied by K2. So now, when we put the 4.3 of the value of the beta there in the equation, and then we can find that the K2 will be equal to 0.215. So we got the value of the K2 already. We got the value of the K1. K1 is equal to 20. And then the K2 is equal to somewhere around 0.215. And then when you need to check with the equation, the spec for the steady state error, because you have the relation. If you put the K1 equal to 20, okay, you will calculate that the K2 should be smaller or equal than 0.25. So if you check this value with this value, basically you are fulfilling this specification as well. Okay? And then also here, if you check the zeta multiplied by omega n, basically will be equal to this real part, which is negative 3.15. So this one we find it is basically greater than negative 1.33, okay, which also fulfilling the settling time specification. Okay, so that's basically is how to find the value of K1 and K2, okay, when we designing the control system. Since it is a design problem, the value of K1 and K2, not only that fixed value like that, it depends, okay? Because for example, in this case, you can select different value of K, because you can put the roots there, okay? And then the value of the K will be lower, okay? The value of alpha will be lower. And when the value of the alpha will be lower, the K1 also will be lower, and then later on it will affect the K2 as well. Okay, so you will get a different set of answer. Okay, but since it is a design problem, okay, the answer can be many. Okay, as long as you fulfill the three specifications that are laid down there, so your answer is correct. The specification is depend from your customer. Okay, they will lay down the specification for you. Okay, if they want the system to be having specification such and such, we just need to follow their specification. Okay, can be tighter, can be, you know, less tighter. Okay, depend on your customer, how they wanted their system is. Okay, the only thing what you need to do, your job is to decide the value of K1 and K2 so that the system is fulfilling that specification. That's all. Okay, if you understand this example, basically you can design a control system. Okay, of course later on we will learn more about different methods and so on in designing. So as summary, students have learned the root locus method can investigate the effect of varying two or more parameter to a system. You have learned also how to determine the parameter of a control system using root locus method. So what you have learned basically will become foundation for analyzing and designing the parameter for feedback control system. This is a slide on Psycos Lab. Okay. Cuma for Psycos Lab ni, sebab saya tak ada masa untuk give a lecture on this to you. So what I want you to do is that open that slide and read it yourself. Okay. So Psycos Lab is basically similar to Scilab. Okay. Cuma the only thing, kalau you talking about MATLAB, okay, MATLAB, you ada MATLAB dengan Simulink. Okay. So when you do MATLAB, basically it's tech based, but when you do the Simulink, it is icon based. Okay. So the Psycos Lab is basically is icon based. Okay. Tapi dia pun juga supporting the command-command yang you gunakan dalam Scilab yang saya ajar sebelum ni. Okay. Jadi buka that slide and baca. Okay, sebelum kamu datang ke lab. Okay. Dan saya selain itu, saya nak kamu load this download this is experiment 1 instruction. Okay, baca. Dan kalau boleh print sekali, boleh bawa ke lab. Okay, bila kamu datang ke lab. Okay. The instruction is quite lengthy. Okay, seterusnya kita sentuh tentang sensitivity and also root locus. Okay, I will explain the utilization of root locus method to define the sensitivity of feedback control system. Okay, this is about section 7.5 in your books. Okay, so whatever you have learned before basically will help your understanding. Okay, when we talk about the sensitivity, I think you're familiar already with that equation. In chapter 4, we have learned that the sensitivity of the transfer function toward the variation in parameter k, okay, can be equated with the dlnt over dlnk, or we can write as dt divided by t, okay, divided by dk over d over k, because this is indicate the percentage change in the transfer function because of the percentage change in the parameter. Okay, so that's what we have understood. Okay, about the sensitivity that we have defined before for a system having a transfer function TS and also parameter. Okay, the only thing is that when we say that the system is changed because of the parameter k is changed, when we say the system is changed, actually the performance of the system will be changing. And normally, when we talk about the performance of the system, as we learn in chapter 5, it is related to the location of the roots. Right? Okay? So that means here, when the performance is changed, the root location also will be changing. Okay? So in that case, we can say that when the parameter k is changing, okay, the position of the root will be changing as well. Right? So that's what we call it as the root sensitivity. Okay? So we can write the root sensitivity with this equation, where S, the sensitivity of the root, Ri is the root, okay, toward the change in the parameter K will be equal to this one, DRi divided by DLNK, or DRi divided by DK over K. Okay, where the Ri is the rth roots of the system. Okay, of course within the system we may have more than one roots, Okay. So we can consider each root individually. Okay. And this relate the changes in the location of the root in the S-plane to the change in the parameter. Okay. So basically, if we change the parameter k, the position of the roots will be changing as well. As we know, the transfer function of the system, we can relate them to the numerator equation and also the denominator equation, where this one is basically k1, a constant, multiplied by multiple of the zero. The only thing, sorry, this equation is zj instead of zi. Okay. And then this is multiple of the poles. So with that, basically, we can have the relation between the sensitivity of the system transfer function to the variable variation in k with the sensitivity of the root location to the changes in parameter k following this equation. This is actually equal to this one, right? The sensitivity of the roots upon the variation in parameter k. Okay, so the the sensitivity of this one of the system are related to that. So the only thing here we need to consider the this is delta z j instead of I. Okay, our dlnk, the logarithm of k, basically is equal to zero. Okay. So at the end, basically, we can write an equation, the relation between in the sensitivity of the system to the sensitivity of the roots, okay, following this equation. Okay, once we have this, okay, the only thing, the sensitivity of the system over this one, we can approximate it as, because it's following this equation, okay, so we can approximate it as delta Ri divided by delta K over K. Okay, the main thing here is for you to remember this equation. On one of the examples, let's say we have a system like this, a closed loop control system with the GS equal to K divided by S multiplied by S plus beta. So from this equation, okay, from this block diagram, you can get the transfer function and then basically the characteristic equation, you can get it from that transfer function, which is equal to 1 plus GS, okay? And then the GS is basically equal to K divided by S multiplied by S plus B. So you have this characteristic equation, okay? And with this equation, okay, you can rearrange this equation to become like this. So you have two constant here, two parameter here. One is beta, another one is k. Okay. In this case also, the k we can change to alpha if we want. Okay. And when we have a variation, okay, when we have variation in the parameter, okay, when the parameter is changing, okay, let's say the parameter alpha here or k, okay, if it is changing, we can imagine that it will change from the nominal value, maybe AO, plus and minus delta alpha. This is because of if this parameter is changing. Okay? Similarly, for beta also, it will be changing from the nominal value of the beta plus and minus delta. I think here should be delta delta. Okay? I'm wrongly write the symbol. Okay. And let's say if we have the nominal value of the beta equal to 1, and then the nominal value of alpha, which is 0.5. Okay. So for the nominal value, if we just plug in the nominal value here, okay, the BO and also the alpha or alpha O, okay, and then we have here, we can substitute here with 1, okay, of course here also we can substitute with 0.5, okay, and then we can rewrite this equation in the form of this one, okay, since this is equal to beta is equal to 1, so this one is become like this, okay. Let's say if the alpha is changing like this, and then we just indicate with the plus and minus alpha, so at the end we replace the AO 0.5, and then we have the equation like this, okay. And then after we having this, we can and show the root locus of this, okay, by rewriting the equation so that delta alpha will become the multiplier, okay. And then from here, basically you can find the roots here, okay. And let's say if the alpha is changing within 20%. So since the nominal value is 0.5, 20% of 0.5 is basically 0.1. Okay, so delta alpha is basically a plus and minus 0.1. Okay, so if it is changing 0.5 from 0.1 from nominal value, so that means the alpha can be 0.4 or it can be 0.6 within that range, okay. Okay, so let's say if we take the alpha equal to 0.6, okay, we can find the roots here for this one, where we will find that the roots, it will be complex root, will become 0.5 plus as J 0.59. The delta R1 is actually will be equal to J multiplied by 0.09, okay. If the alpha is, we take the value of 0.4, okay, we will get the roots location will be here, okay, okay, where the difference is actually the delta R1 is actually negative J multiplied by 0.11, okay. And then if we calculate the sensitivity, okay, of the root for the variation in the K, in this case we have two variation, which is positive and negative. Positive will become 0.6, negative it becomes 0.4. So we have this value that we have calculated just now, divided by this delta K divided by K. Okay, since delta K is basically is equal to 1, delta K is 0.1, where just now we have this one, and the K is basically 0.5, that's why we have 0.2 here, okay. And then if we calculate this one, basically we got this value will become 0.45J, okay. And this one basically will indicate that it is, the value is 0.45, the magnitude, and the angle is 90 degrees, okay, because there is no real part, okay, plus 90 degrees, okay. And then for the other one, okay, for the sensitivity of the root, okay, because of the change in the parameter K in the negative direction, which is 0.4, okay, we put in this equation. So since the delta R1 is equal to negative 0.11 J, and then this ratio is basically 0.2, So if we divide that, we get the sensitivity of this, the position of the R1 toward the change in parameter K in negative direction is equal to negative 0.55 J, or we can say it is the distance it is moving is 0.55 and the direction is minus 90 degree. Okay, so that is basically the movement of the root, okay, because of the change in the parameter K. So if you plot it in the graph, basically this is the position of the root, okay, when the K is equal to nominal value, and this is the position of the root when it is nominal, the other position. And if we increase the K, okay, 20% and positively, so it will move to this direction, okay. So the root now, the position will move from this position to here, okay, and the one which is here will move to position here, okay. If we reduce it 20% of the K, what will happen? It will move to this direction downward, and this one also will move to this direction, okay. So that is the change in the position of the roots when the parameter K is changing. And similarly, we can look also at the second parameter, which is beta. 20% is just, we just assuming that it is given. Yeah, you can say 10%, you can say whatever lah. Okay, depend on the question lah. Okay. Okay, as before as well, that beside working on the only the parameter K or alpha, now we can also work on the parameter beta. Okay, the only thing now that we need to make the beta as the multiplier. Okay, so it's the same thing, the K is equal to alpha. I'm sorry lah sebab the formula di sini yang saya tulis, saya paste daripada yang tadi tu dan saya tak tukar lagi. Saya tak perasan. Okay, ini sebenarnya sama macamnya alpha tadi. Okay, jadi sepatutnya this is the second parameter which is beta. Jadi kita sepatutnya buat untuk beta lah. Kalau di sini kita still vary the alpha. Nampak? Rasa cuma kita akan repeat macam tadi balik lah. Cuma sekarang ni kita buat for beta. Okay? And then fix the alpha O equal to 0.5. Okay? And then kita mungkin akan dapat jawapan dia yang berlainan sedikit lah. Sebab ini pun it's not 90 degree anymore. Okay? Because of the root locus, because of the beta is in this direction. Okay? Sorry, saya tak perasan yang ni. Okay? Tapi tak apalah, nanti saya akan ubah the slide ni, the equation yang ada dekat slide ni. Then maybe later on you akan uncheck balik tentang how you derive for the beta. Okay, so basically you have learned that the root sensitivity relate the change in the location of the root in the S-plane to change in the parameter. Okay, so what you have learned here will become the foundation for analyzing and designing the parameter for feedback control system. Okay, ada soalan tak? Tak ada. Okay, kalau tak ada kita jumpa lagi esok.